Hi everyone, my name is Megan and we're running a really fun study right after class about mindfulness and vision. It shouldn't take more than 10 to 15 minutes, so if you're interested, we need more than 60 people, so just come up to the front after class and it won't take a long time. It's really fun. Thank you.
Now there's a story about Gertrude Stein, and she was taking a philosophy class with William James right here in the yard, and they had their final exam, and it was a spring semester course, and she comes into the exam, and it's a day like today, and the exam is about metaphysics and the meaning of life. So she opens the exam and writes, "Today is too beautiful a day to take an exam," and she walks out. And you know, as legend has it, of course, she gets a straight A in William James's class. Don't use that as an example or as an excuse later on in the semester. But I really appreciate you being here today. It is a beautiful day. I was thinking of having the class outside, but I think maybe we should. Yeah. What we're going to do today is finish up on relationships. We have just a little to go, and then start with our final topic for the course, which is self-esteem. So let me just recap what we did when we discussed relationships. So we talked about how do we, given our natures, how do we attain, how do we sustain lasting love, lasting passion, when it seems, on the physiological level at least, that our natures are not attuned to that approach. And we talked about, when studying the best relationships, the tip of the stem, four characteristics based on the work of David Schnark and John Gottman. The first one is relationship is hard work. It's an illusion to think that the most important thing is finding the right relationship. It is more important to cultivate that one chosen relationship. And just like we would not thrive, succeed at work if we said, well, I just found my dream job, and then put our legs up and relax. Similarly, we would not thrive in a relationship if we have the finding mindset. We just need to find it, and then we'll live happily ever after. As we talked about, movies end where love begins. The second component of a healthy, lasting, and passionate relationship, related to the first one, is the notion of being known rather than being validated. Expressing rather than impressing. Being open, revealing our weaknesses as well as our strengths, our desires, our passions, our fears and insecurities. And relationships that do that, or partners that do that within a relationship, over time attain higher and higher levels of intimacy, happiness, and they thrive, and they maintain their passion. That's the second component. The third component of a healthy relationship is that there are conflicts there. It is an illusion to believe that the ideal relationship is one that is conflict-free. That doesn't exist unless both partners are suppressing serious issues. So there are conflicts in relationship. The challenge is to have more positivity than negativity, of course, in the relationship, and also to learn how to be in the midst of disagreement, how to have conflict. And finally, the fourth point that we talked about was positive perception, being a benefit finder, and more than that, being a benefit creator. I want to just go back quickly and elaborate on something that I didn't last time about the conflict or conflict within a relationship. I think the most important essay, article that I read about relationships in general was the article on friendship by Ralph Waldo Emerson, published in 1841. And what Emerson writes about is his ideal friend. Let me quote him. He says, "In a friend, what I'm looking for is not a mush of concessions, a person who will agree with everything that I say. Rather, what I'm looking for is a beautiful enemy, a person who will challenge me, who will push me, who will help me in my apprenticeship to the truth. A beautiful enemy. What a beautiful phrase. A conflict-free relationship is where there are no beautiful enemies. A beautiful enemy is a person who loves us, who cares about us enough to challenge us, enough to disagree. And ask yourself, what kind of friend, what kind of romantic partner would you like? A yes man or woman? Or a person who will be honest, who will have high levels of integrity? What is the ideal friend? What is the ideal partner? You know, it's interesting, this whole idea of a beautiful enemy goes way back. And it goes back to one of the, if not the most influential text in certainly the Western world, which is the Bible. In Genesis, God sees that man is alone, so he creates a help meet for him. A woman. A help meet. What does that phrase mean? This is the King James translation. Well, if you look at it in the Hebrew original, help meet is ezer kenegdo, or help as opposition. In other words, the help meet translation, the meet part, M-E-E-T, is like an athletic meet, like a competition. Not helping and they meet together. It's help as opposition. And already then it was noticed that the ideal relationship is not one which is all smooth, conflict-free. It is one where there is some resistance. And it's this resistance that Gottman talked about in the 21st century that is so important, so critical for a healthy relationship. A beautiful enemy. Help as opposition. Help meet. Again, with a lot of positivity in the relationship as well. So let me move on and just finish up on positive perception. I want to show you an excerpt from one of my favorite movies, I think one of the best movies, certainly in the realm of psychology ever made, from As Good As It Gets. And here is the part where Holly Hunter tells Jack Nicholson that he better give her a compliment, and it better be a good compliment, because if it is not, she's getting up and leaving. He had just said something very offensive to her. So here is what he has to say to the woman he loves.
Okay. Now, I got a real great compliment for you, and it's true.
I'm so afraid you're about to say something awful.
Don't be pessimistic. It's not your style. Okay. Here I go. It's clearly a mistake. I've got this, ailment. My doctor, a shrink that I used to go to all the time, says that in 50 or 60% of the cases, a pill really helps. I hate pills. Very dangerous thing, pills. Hate. I'm using the word hate here about pills. Hate. My compliment is, that night when you came over and told me that you would never... All right, well, you were there. You know what you said. Well, my compliment to you is, the next morning, I started taking the pills.
I don't quite get how that's a compliment for me.
You make me want to be a better man.
That's maybe the best compliment of my life.
Well, maybe I overshot a little because I was aiming at just enough to keep you from walking out.
This is the essence of benefit creating. You make me want to be a better man, a better woman, a better person. You make me want to do the dishes as well. What do we do then? How do we get a relationship or partners in a relationship to focus on the positive, to focus on the benefit, to focus on creating more good there? Well, we're going back to the very first lesson, very first class, and that is the importance of questions. Remember, questions begin a quest. When we ask a certain question, we see certain things that we didn't see before. When we ask a certain question, we're also avoiding or not seeing part of reality. Remember the geometric shapes. It's all you saw. You didn't see colors. You didn't see children on the bus. Most of you did not see the clock. And very often in relationships, the questions that we ask after the honeymoon is, what's wrong? What happened? Or what can be improved? And again, these are important questions with very good intentions, but we just avoid or don't see an important part of reality. So the questions that we need to ask are also the positive questions, questions that will allow us to see the children on the bus. What am I grateful for in my partner? And it's important to do that always, especially during difficult times, because there's always something to appreciate. And if we don't appreciate that thing, the good depreciates, whether it applying to our country, to our organization, to our relationship, as well as to ourselves. Second positive question, what is wonderful about our relationship? What's working? Why are we together in the first place? What do I love about him, her, us? What's good? And when we ask what's good, that's when we perceive it. And when we perceive it, when we appreciate it, it appreciates. It's not a surprise that the statistics are as they are, what we saw last time, that most relationships flounder, and even those that stay together don't really thrive. No, it's no coincidence. It's because most of the questions that we ask, again, with good intentions, no one has the intention, certainly not going into a relationship, to end it or not to thrive in it. But most of the questions that we ask, that we are taught to ask, are the ones that focus us on the metaphorical geometric shapes. And what we need to do is open up a new quest, new opportunities, see things that are there all along that we simply have overlooked. Again, the quote from Robert M. Pirsig's book, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. So often we look for the truth, and then the truth comes and knocks on our door, and we say to it, go away, I'm looking for the truth. Very often it's right in front of us. All we need to do is look. And one way to look, one way to guide our attention toward what is right in front of us, is by asking also the positive questions. Okay, so what do we have so far? In terms of creating a more positive relationship, in terms of being a benefit creator, we want to focus on the potential. But there's one more thing that we can do, and that is communicating about positive events. This is taken from the work of Shelley Gable from UCLA, who's done, to my mind, the most important work in the area of positive psychology as it relates to relationships. You see, there's a lot of research that has been done on negative communication, meaning what we saw last time. How do you disagree? So rather have a cognitive disagreement rather than an affective or emotional disagreement. Focus on the substance, focus on the behavior rather than on the person, on the emotions. So we know that there is a lot of research in organizational behavior, in couples counseling research, and so on. There has been almost no research done on positive communication between couples, which is in line with most of the research done in psychology. Again, remember the ratio 21 to 1. Now it's a little bit less, but around 20-to-1 ratio, positive to negative negative research. Same when it comes to relationship, no exception, unfortunately. Here comes Shelley Gable and says, well, we also need to focus on what is working. And she started to study positive communication about positive events. And lo and behold, what she found was quite remarkable. In fact, what she found was that the way couples communicate about positive events is a better predictor of long-term success in relationships than how they communicate about negative events. When things go well, better predictor of long-term thriving, passionate relationship than when things do not go well. So when I come home and tell my partner, oh, I just did this and it was amazing, or I've just seen this and it was breathtaking, or this is what's going on at work, this is what's going on in my personal life, and it's a good thing, how my partner responds predicts our long-term success of the relationship. Specifically, what Gable is talking about is active, constructive responding. What is active, constructive responding? What she does is it divided into a 2x2, and I'm going to present the 2x2 now. This is taken directly from the work of three of my colleagues, Jen Elsner, Barbara Hellman, and Amanda Horn from Australia. And here is what they did. Put Shelley Gable's work into an understandable, clear 2x2. So we have, on the one dimension, constructive versus destructive communication. On the other dimension, active versus passive communication. Let's go through the four boxes using an example. My partner comes home from work and she says, I just got a promotion. The promotion that I've been waiting for so long, I was just told that I got it. How do I respond? Well, if I'm passive and destructive, I show no interest, divert attention, I say, mm-hmm, and just move on or talk about, but did you see we got a new flower in the garden? Just talk about something unrelated to it. Divert attention. This is passive and destructive. Now, destructive and active. Just got a promotion, she comes home, and my response is, oh no, this means we'll even have less time to spend together. What does this mean about our children now? Or what about our holiday that we were going to go on next month? It's not possible now, is it? Destructive and active. Then there is passive constructive. This is the most common response. Oh, that's great, wonderful. Mm-hmm. Wow. And then there is the fourth box, the active and constructive, which is, you were just, that is amazing. Tell me all about it. So what happened? Did the boss call you into his office and tell you, how did it happen? Or we have to celebrate. Or let's call our friends and go out. This is amazing. Well done. You've worked so hard for it. I'm so happy for you. Active, constructive. As it turns out, there are consequences, ramifications to each one of these responses. Unfortunately, this, the active and constructive, not very common. Not very common among partners, especially after the honeymoon phase. So when initially the physiological, the novelty, excitement is there, that happens more often. But after a while, this goes away, and with it, as Shelley Gables has shown, the success of the relationship in the long term. Now, the thing about active constructive responding is that it applies to numerous areas in our lives, not just to romantic relationships. How I communicate with my roommates, how I communicate with my family, parents, children. As a therapist, how I communicate with my clients. Because again, most of what psychology has been about is for the therapist to sit there and to be passive constructive. To smile, wonderful. And then what happened? As opposed to active constructive, and there are consequences. It doesn't mean it's the right approach in every relationship every time, because there are a few constraints here. For example, it has to be win-win events. Let's say my partner comes from work and says, Tal, you won't believe it. I just made the most amazing love with my colleague. He was unbelievable. In fact, I'd never felt this way before. Now, active constructive, do tell more, and what happened then? Very difficult to be actively constructive in this situation, for most people, present company included, very difficult. So it's about win-win, but that's not a win-win as far as I can see. It has to be a win-win. In other words, something that both of us, or the relationship, will benefit from, or at the very least, that the other person is not hurt by it. It has to be genuine. It cannot be fake. Because that comes through, especially once the partner knows you. Over time, it just doesn't work. It has to be genuine, meaning we have to get into the role of our partner. Identify with, empathize with, be one with, so that we can genuinely respond to it. And if we do genuinely respond to it, and if it is a win-win event, that's when it generates upward spiral on a few levels. First of all, remember, usually when a positive event happens, what happens? There is a spike up, and then effective forecasting, Gilbert's work shows, goes back down again. What effective constructive responding does, which is, okay, tell me more. So how was it? Let's celebrate. Give me more details. I want to know. I'm interested. What it does to that spike is prolong it. It actually keeps it going for much longer than it would have had it just been a positive event and then back to base level. Because we know no matter what promotion we get at work, initially it feels great. No matter what raise, initially it feels wonderful. And then it goes back down again to base level. Active constructive responding actually elongates that raising, that improvement in well-being. So that's one spiral that it creates, feeling better. The second spiral is an interpersonal spiral, meaning a person who actively, constructively responds genuinely enters the same upward spiral, meaning people who do that genuinely become happier as a result of it because they experience the event. And they themselves benefit and become happier. Again, a win-win, potentially. And finally, it also does what positive psychology as a whole does, which is build positive capacity. Remember, positive psychology takes us not just from the zero to the positive, it also helps us better deal with the negative to the zero. Partners who actively, constructively respond to one another are building capacity for hard times. In fact, one of the most interesting researches that were done a long time ago was that couples where things went well, where they were, essentially where they actively, constructively responded to one another and supported one another back in the 1920s. Once the Great Depression hit, the relationship actually became better, whereas partners who didn't have it good before, the relationship very often dissolved, became worse. In other words, when they built the capacity, it helped them also deal with hard times, such as 1929 and the 1930s. There are no shortcuts when it comes to good relationships, to healthy relationships. It is hard work if you want to succeed, just like it is in every other domain in life. There are no shortcuts. However, that doesn't mean that the hard work cannot be enjoyable, cannot be pleasurable, as well as meaningful. And when that hard work is pleasurable and meaningful, over time, that leads to a happier relationship, happier individuals, to a win-win togetherness. I want to end but just addressing a point that many of you have raised with me. And that is, should we even talk about relationship in the context of the pursuit of happiness? And the answer for most people is yes, with some discomfort. Yes, because it's the number one generator of the ultimate currency. Some discomfort, because pursuing happiness is, by its nature, selfish. I mean, after all, when I'm thinking about my happiness, I'm thinking, by definition, about the self. And shouldn't a relationship be about the opposite of selfishness? In other words, about altruism. So let me say just a few words about this. Let's take an example from teaching. Imagine this. Imagine that I actually don't like teaching. I don't like to teach. I don't like coming here on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And in fact, it's very painful for me. However, I have a deep sense of duty because of my upbringing, because of the philosophies that I read. I have a deep sense of duty to other people. And I know that positive psychology is or has some important messages to give people, and therefore I teach it. Not because I like it, but because I think it can potentially help other people. And I wake up on Tuesdays and Thursday mornings and I dread going to class. The hour and a half seems like eternity to me. The last thing in the world I want to do is teach, but I'm driven by my sense of duty because I'm an altruist. I'm sacrificing myself for what I think is a greater good. Now think of the alternative. Imagine this teacher, and then imagine the alternative. And the alternative is me. I love teaching. There is nowhere else I would rather be right now than here. I love positive psychology. I can't wait to get into my computer and write the lectures. I can't wait to prepare the PowerPoints and work hard on Google Image to do so. I can hardly wait to interact with you. I love being here every Tuesday and Thursday. It is my passion. It is my calling. It is both pleasurable and meaningful to me to spend time with you. And now I ask you, which teacher would you rather have? The teacher who is here out of a sense of duty, for altruistic reasons, or the person who is here for selfish reasons, because he would rather be here more than any other place? I also ask you, which teacher do you think would be a better teacher? And now I ask you, which partner would you rather have? A partner who is with you just because they feel like, well, that person really needs me, or I feel sorry for the person. I don't really like that person, but I'm there just to be there for them because out of a sense of duty. Or would you rather have a person who is with you because you're the most important person in their lives, because they care about so much that the I becomes a we? They care about you as much as they care about themselves. They include you in their circle of the self. Which relationship do you think will thrive more? Now, that does not mean that there is no sacrifice in relationships. That does not mean that if my partner is unwell or needs my help, I will not go out of my way, even if it means giving up some things that I really, really want to do at that point. Of course, in healthy relationships, when the I becomes the we, sacrifice exists, and there is healthy sacrifice. But it's not a relationship that is based fundamentally on a sense of duty or altruistic negation of the self. As Nathaniel Brandon says, the more independent we are, the more interdependent we can become. That's when the I becomes a we. Again, this is something which goes against much of our teachings. It's not always easy to accept. But again, this class, much more than it is about positive psychology, is about reality psychology. And ask yourself, what partner would you rather be? What partner would you rather have? What teacher would you rather have? Completely analogous. Okay, let's move on now to the very last topic of this class. As I've said many times, I never procrastinate. I just use Google Image. I started to think explicitly about the topic of self-esteem when I was a senior, as an undergraduate here. I started to think about it when I noticed another phenomenon. So that was after I'd switched into philosophy and psychology. I was very happy in my concentration. I was very happy in playing on the squash team. Harvard was going great for me. But then I started to notice something that was unclear, didn't make sense to me. And that was the fact that I had low self-esteem, or so it seemed at least, and it didn't make sense to me. Because I was doing well, I had won prizes, I'd received a lot of accolades, a lot of support, whether it's from my roommates, friends, family, a lot of pats on the back in athletics, in academics, and yet I had low self-esteem, and it just didn't make sense to me. And there was another thing that baffled me even more. It was as if, on some level, I was punished by success. What do I mean by that? Every time when I would succeed, or when I did get praise, my self-esteem would increase, would improve. But then, very quickly afterwards, it went down, back to its base level, and even lower. And in order to raise it back up again, I needed even more praise, even more accolades than I needed before. And the metaphor that kept on coming to mind was Sisyphus pushing a rock up a mountain. I would push that rock up the mountain, struggle, till the next victory came. And the next victory came, and I got the praise, I got the accolades, I got the prize. And my self-esteem was high. I was on top of the mountain. And then this rock would be rolled down again. And I would have to run down and start pushing it up again, only this time the hill was even steeper. And I would have to struggle even more. And I would get up there again, and then it rolled back down. Now it wasn't enough to have the accolade, the praise, the amount, the quality, and the quantity that I had before. I needed even more just to get onto the same mountain, even steeper, even more difficult, and it didn't make sense to me. And then I took a class. Senior year ended up being one of my favorite classes for various reasons which I will not go into now. Fairy tales. I took fairy tales and we read Emile, Rousseau's Emile, and Maria Tatar talked about wonderful theories, and it clicked. I ended up writing my senior thesis, my final paper for that class on self-esteem, and that eventually became my dissertation. That's what I actually wrote my PhD on, this topic. So what I want to do today is share with you some of the insights that I got in fairy tales, as well as other thinkers who have been thinking about this topic of self-esteem, because it is important. It is not for nothing that I end the course with the topic of self-esteem, because it is at the foundation, at the core of so many of the other things that we discussed, whether it's healthy relationships, whether it's happiness in general, whether it's benefit finding or benefit creating, whether it's being known rather than validated. Self-esteem encompasses so many of these ideas. So here is what we're going to do. First of all, we're going to talk about why it is important. A lot of misunderstanding about what self-esteem is and is not. We're going to talk about some theories that can apply to our lives. Then we'll elaborate on the paradox that I just talked about, that sometimes success actually leads to lower levels of self-esteem. And why does that happen? We'll explain that. And then I'll introduce essentially my dissertation on self-esteem, where I divided the one construct into three distinct components, which are dependent self-esteem, self-esteem that is generated by others, praise, approval, independent self-esteem, self-esteem that comes from within, self-esteem that is not contingent on what other people say, self-generated, and finally, unconditional self-esteem, or a state of being, where we simply and naturally exist. So I'll talk about these three levels and how we can cultivate independent as well as unconditional self-esteem. And finally, we'll end by next time by talking about how we can enhance our levels of self-esteem. Now, many people, when they listen to a lecture on self-esteem, go into evaluation mode and say, okay, so do I have high self-esteem? I meaning you. Or is my self-esteem higher than the person sitting next to me, or my partner, or friend? And the answer to this question is, you can't really know. I mean, we can't measure self-esteem, quote-unquote, objectively. We don't really know where it is in the brain yet. We may be able to 10 years from now or 20 years from now. But that's not an important question. Just like, am I happy or not, is not an important question. In fact, a misleading question. The question, rather, remember, is, how can I become happier? The same with self-esteem. The question is not, do I have high or low self-esteem, but rather, how can I enhance my self-esteem? Because as I'll argue shortly, there cannot be too much self-esteem. But sometimes people associate with too much self-esteem, which is arrogance and conceit and narcissism, is not self-esteem. In fact, it's the exact opposite. It's lack thereof. But having a stronger sense of self is a good thing. And the question is, how can I enhance it? Today my self-esteem is higher than it was when I started thinking about it 15 years ago, and hopefully 15 years or 5 years from now, it will be higher than it is today. It is a lifelong process, and we'll talk about how that lifelong process unfolds and what we can do to expedite it, to intensify it. So first of all, definition of self-esteem. There are numerous definitions. Let me read you just a few from the main thinkers in the area. So Albert Bandura, Stanford professor, explains gauging self-esteem, quote, in terms of how people evaluate themselves. Those who express the sense of unworthiness are said to have low self-esteem, whereas persons who express self-pride are said to hold themselves in high esteem. Another well-known thinker in the area, Germain, defines self-esteem as the judgment and feelings about the self. Very simply, the judgment and feelings about the self. Cooper Smith, one of the most important thinkers in the area, self-esteem is an evaluation which an individual makes and customarily maintains with regard to himself. It expresses an attitude of approval or disapproval and indicates the extent to which the individual believes himself to be capable, significant, successful, and worthy. Capable, significant, successful, and worthy. In short, self-esteem is a personal judgment of worthiness that is expressed in the attitudes the individual holds toward himself. It's about the attitude that I have toward myself. It's the evaluative part of the self-concept. The definition that I will use, and that I use in my dissertation, and I think that captures best what self-esteem is about, is Nathaniel Brandon's. Nathaniel Brandon, considered by many to be the father of the self-esteem movement in this country, if not the world, a therapist and a philosopher that has been working in the area for